We are been working through lessons from a sheepdog, Phillip Keller, and his female dog, Lass, who is a border collie. And this particular week, as this journey is progressing for Lass and for Phillip, Phillip writes here as a chapter heading, The Delight of Obedience. My question to you this morning is, can an old dog learn new tricks? What do you think? I know that we retrieved Hudson from a couple friends of ours in Bastrop, and Hudson was like 2.5, 3 maybe, somewhere around there, 3. And actually, Jarrett is a dog trainer. He is a bird dog trainer. And he looked at Hudson and he said, "She's not going to work. Move along, little doggy." That kind of thing. I don't know that Jarrett was saying it was impossible. I think what he was trying to say was it was going to be really tedious. You're going to have a lot of patience, a lot of long suffering. You would rather have a little baby dog to start working with than having to teach an old dog new tricks. It's hard to do. Now, the good news is we're not dogs. We're human beings, so we work a little bit differently. However, there's some real parallels in this journey, particularly with Lass being a little older and already learned some really bad habits. For Phillip to be able to get Lass and take her from a situation where she was good for nothing but to chase kids on bicycles and other dogs to becoming a productive sheepdog, it was quite a feat. It took a master. It took someone like Phillip, a person with a lot of patience and a lot of love. And I'll tell you something else. It took somebody like Phillip who could see, who had the vision of what Lass could become with a little work. A lot of parallels here. The first thing that Lass had to learn as she began to trust Phillip, and that was really the biggest obstacle to overcome, probably not just for old dogs, but for people, because they had this past experience and they've been lied to. And with people, of course, we have the flesh. So we have these skeletons in our closet, we have the flesh, we have these bad experiences, we have rejection, particularly with people who have lost their father at a young age or never knew their father at a young age, or their father died. They have a real struggle in initiating and beginning this trust relationship between them and the Lord, because we address God as who? Our Heavenly Father. And so they make this unfortunate connection. So this journey that Lass and Phillip were on required Lass to learn some fundamental basic calls. So Phillip talks about it here, and he says, the lessons taught her were intense and uncomplicated. The words of command were short and to the point. Come, sit, fetch, stay, stop, down, right, left, and so on. These are like some of the commands I hear in my home. Just kidding, honey. Yeah, somebody's in the doghouse. Yeah, right. I stay there. So, old Lass, she is... she's learning all these things, and what Phillip discovered was that this relationship, because it was based on trust, eventually Lass came to the point where she could say, she would come to Phillip and say, he's got my best interest in mind. But it took a while for her to get there. She was so afraid from all her past experiences. And she thought, well, that was just going to be more of the same with Phillip. It took a while for her to discover it's not the same. That Phillip had her best interests in mind. That Phillip wanted to develop her and help her reach her potential. So as she is learning to trust Phillip and beginning to see those things, she responded in learning these calls. Why? Because once she knew that she could trust Phillip, she had an innate desire to please him. In fact, Phillip noticed that when she obeyed to Philip's commands, that tail went 100 miles an hour. She was steadfastly looking at Philip. Her ear was cocked, ready for the next command. And you could see, Philip said he could see the delight that was within her in following and pleasing her master. In fact, the neighbors would come by and they would stand on the fence post there and they would watch in amazement and they would say to Philip, you can tell it is riveting all throughout her body that the one sole thing she wants to do is to please you, Philip. And Philip began to think about that relationship in parallel to his relationship with God. He noticed something. He noticed that Lass was much quicker to get through the hurdles of her life and respond to her master than was Philip. He was a little slower. Now, Philip didn't become a Christian early in life. He was not late. He was not early. He was just kind of middle, somewhere early middle, somewhere in there. He didn't exactly give his age, but he had already learned some bad ways of life, as we all do when we grow up without the Lord. And so he noticed that he struggled a little bit, much more so than Lass did, with his will to submit it to God's will. He said, you know, we all are like that. And he began to ask himself, you know, about his attention, the lack of attention that he had for the Lord. In fact, what he noted was that many times as human beings, we seem to be more attentive to pleasing others than pleasing who? Than pleasing God. See, that doesn't really sink well when you're trying to develop an intimate relationship. Now, the scripture verse for us today is in John 15, 14 and 15. Here's what it says. Here's what John says. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. Now, when we grow up in life, many times the world says that following God is a losing proposition. You should be like the rich man. Drink, you know, make bigger barns, be merry, enjoy your life, make your middle name hedonism, and then you die. And God says no. And so, but when particularly young people, when they start to follow the Lord, many times they're ridiculed and they're looked as being strange because they're sharing their faith and they're going to church and they're saying no to all these temptations. And there are people in the world going, man, you're crazy, man. You should be living it up. You should be having a great time. And many times people in the world, they say these things because they don't know what the master has in store for them. They've been lied to. I remember meeting a young lady when I was very young, and I told her about I was considering at that time answering a call to ministry. I felt I had this call and I felt like I was going to go down this road and follow the Lord. And she said, oh, what a waste. Now that's a worldly point of view, because the world doesn't understand what God, our Heavenly Father, has in store for us. Now this verse, or these verses, give a hint to what the Lord has in store for us. Remember when we had our New Year's message, we talked about a theme for 2017. We were going to ask the Lord each day to make us a better friend. Remember that? A better friend. You see, these verses speak about that God doesn't just have service in mind for you, but this service is going to develop, it's going to progress into something much richer, much deeper, and that deeper, richer thing is friendship. God wants you and him to be friends. Now, these verses tell us what friends do. Now, you have friends, then you have close friends. And then you have friends maybe on one hand, maybe on a couple fingers, that you share confident stuff with them because you know that you can trust them. And you know that you can receive some help from them. Now, here's what Jesus said. No longer have I called you servants. Now I'm going to call you friends. And here's what I do with friends. What does it say? All things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. God seeks to communicate with you. Now, that's not an end in and of itself. It's a means. But that's where we begin. And when God begins to first work with us, he gives us speaking commands. He starts us off with the easy ones, right? He didn't start us off with the hard ones, but with the easy ones. He wants us to make sure when we're new believers, as we're growing with the Lord, that we're going to hear from God, that we're going to hear his voice, and he wants us to feel his closeness. And that's the way it is many times when we first get saved. To prepare us in this relationship for a closer friendship. I think about Abraham in Genesis chapter 18. Here God came in a theophany in a person with two other angels, and he showed up there with Abraham at his tent. In Genesis 18, God demonstrated this friendship. And he told Abraham that Sarah was going to have a child in the next year, and they worked through that little thing, and then they were about to walk away, remember? And the Lord said to the other two angels, wait a minute. He's having a conversation with the other two angels. He said, should I keep secret or should I tell Abraham what I'm about to do? And he turned around and he told him. See, that is a mark of friendship when you speak about intimate things. Now, communication that God gives is not an end in and of itself. It's a means to an end. Why did God communicate to Abraham? Do you remember what he told him? What was he about to do in Genesis 18? He's going to go down to Sodom and Gomorrah, and he's going to destroy those two cities. Why did God feel like it was important to tell Abraham about this terrible event that was about to occur? Because Lot and his family lived there. And what did the Lord want to do? He wanted to give Abraham an opportunity to help his brother-in-law and their family. And sure enough, what did Abraham do upon hearing about what God was going to do? He stood up and he spoke eventually for Lot and their family. And they escaped that terrible destruction. Well, of course, the case, except for Mrs. Lot. She got out of Sodom, but Sodom didn't get out of her. So God communicated this great truth in friendship to Abraham so that God could help Abraham do what? Help someone else. Now, that's what God wants to do in your life, in my life. The marks of friendship are communication so that you can then help others. Now, this communication to help others is on a progression on the learning curve. This little thing that happened in chapter 18 was nothing compared to how God communicated to Abraham several years later. You remember Isaac was born. We think he was a young teenager. Abraham had grown to love his only son through Sarah. He was the promise. Oh, he was Abraham's, the apple of his eye. And God comes to him again and communicates to him, Abraham, take your son, your only son, and go and sacrifice him. Now, Philip said that these speaking, if I can get back here, these speaking commands that he gave were easy. He said, but later on, he said, I needed last to do greater things. So he said, I had to start teaching her more advanced and demanding hand signals instead of spoken words of command. He had to start with the easy, but then he needed more difficult commands, because what is he helping Lass to do? Is he just helping Lass so that Lass can be a good border collie and obey him and run circles if that's what the master wants him to do? No. What's Lass doing? Lass is taking care of the sheep. Lass is enabled by the master so Lass can go help the sheep and help the ranch and take care of everything that the sheep need. But the spoken commands were not suffice. More was needed. And so he spoke about these hand signals that he taught Lass. For instance, if she was running toward me at high speed, I only had to raise my arm vertically with hand fully extended, and she would drop to the ground all at once. It was essential that she master this means of communication. Why? Because Lass was going to be put in positions where sometimes she was too far away to hear the voice of her master. Sometimes she was maybe even just could barely see him. That's why he needed to give her hand signals from a distance. So because she couldn't hear him, and plus he didn't want to yell that loud. She learned those, and because she learned them, she was able to take care of the sheep in the way that her master wanted her to. When God came to Abraham in Genesis 18, it was to help him help others, particularly Lot and his family. But God had bigger plans than that. But Abraham had to learn to trust the Lord before he could get to the real communication, the most effective communication that God wanted to give him. Not only to be a blessing to Isaac and his own family, but to all the nations of the world. Here's the problem. Many of us are indifferent to the things of the Lord. Our delight is not so much pleasing God as it is pleasing others, pleasing our peers, pleasing those who are around us in school or at work. And that's why we are afraid to step out there and speak for the Lord and do something that they might deem as funny or strange. With Lass, his sole delight was to please his master. Do you know what God wants? He wants your life to be in such accord with him in friendship that everybody, when they see you, they see you wagging your tail because you enjoy pleasing the Lord. Here's what God gives in this friendship. He gives you communication so that you can help others. And in that helping others, Boy, he fills you with joy. Don't let the devil rob you. Don't let him lie to you that this is a drag to serve and please the Lord. No, it is the most exciting adventure in the whole world. Just this week, my sister called me. I'll close with this, Sharla, and we got to talking about this other young lady that was a friend of ours in high school that has colon cancer, and we were praying for her. And so I said, Sharla, you know, what do you think about Mom? You know, Mom has prayed the sinner's prayer, you know, several times, but she doesn't go to church. And I said, Sharla, I just don't think she probably reads her Bible. And so all she's hearing from is everything else out there in the world. And I think that if she had an opportunity from hearing from God in the Word, that I think her life would change. And Sharla agreed. And Sharla came up with a suggestion. She said, you know what? She said, I have my little devotion. I think when I have Mom and I have coffee at the same time, even though they live in two different places, I'll just call her when I'm having my coffee and read my devotion to her. I said, now that's awesome, Sharla. That's where it's at. Who gave us that idea? God did. He was communicating to us for what? So that we could sit on it? No, so we could help somebody else, in this case, our own mom. And I tell you, after I hung up the phone, I don't know how Charlotte felt, but I was wagging my tail. That's where you want to go. Friendship. God wants to develop his friendship with you. Will you let him? I would say this to conclude. Yes, old dogs can learn new tricks. Let's pray. Maybe there's something in your life that you need to pray about today, something you heard today, something that God put his finger on. Ask the Lord to help you.